So far, we've talked about how quality management systems, if they are effective, de-emphasize the need for inspections. But we need to start talking about sampling plans, which are necessary to guarantee that you're achieving the level of quality and safety that you're guaranteeing. So have you ever wondered how companies come up with the design of their sampling plans? Sampling plans can be very costly, very time-consuming, and a big part of your operations. So getting the sampling plan just right is very imperative and important. So the point of this lecture, which is part of a series of video lectures, is to start talking about acceptance sampling.
I think the best way to start out looking at these acceptance plans is just to see what one looks like. So let's say we have an acceptance plan that has a big N of 9,000, a little N of 60, and let's say C and R are 1 and 5 respectfully. So we have two terms here that should be familiar to you. What does the capital N represent? You guessed it right. That is the lot. So we have a lot of 9,000 units, whereas the little N is 60. So we're going to take a sample of 60 out of this lot of 9,000. Now, what do C and R represent? C represents the number at which we can accept this sample of 60. So let's say we pick 60. If we have one or fewer non-conforming units, then thumbs up, we can move forward and ship that product out. But what does R mean? R is the value at which we have to reject this lot. So if we have 60 in our sample and we have 5, 6, 7, or even 20 non-conforming units, then we're going to reject that lot. Okay, so I'm going to make things just a little bit more complicated by introducing real briefly another type of sampling plan. In this one, we might say, okay, if we fall in between, let's say we have 2, 3, or 4 non-conforming units, then we got to figure out what to do. It's not 1 or less, it's not 5 or greater, so what do we do in this situation? Well, this is going to be double acceptance sampling plan, where we might say if we have 2, 3, or 4, then we're going to sample again. So in this case, C might be, let's say it's 6. So if we have 6 or fewer non-conforming units, we can accept. And in that case, it might be 2 from the first one and maybe 4 from the second one. Those combined represent 6, so we could accept. Whereas, maybe the R is, let's say we're going to reject if we have 8 or fewer. So we could have 3 and 3, and those together would be 6 again. So we would be fine with that. We would move on. We would accept that lot. But if we had, let's say we had maybe 4 and 4, or maybe 4 and 5, or anything like that, that would equal 8, and in that case, we would reject. Okay, so I just introduced two types of acceptance sampling plans, single and double. We're going to talk about these in quite a few detail before we get to the others, because we really need to get the basics down. But the other ones are multiple and sequential. And by the time we get to those, they should be pretty easy, because we will have gone through single and double acceptance sampling plan in such detail that anything from there on is just a rendition of what we already know. Okay, so what I want to show you next is operating characteristic curves, also commonly referred to as OC curves. Okay, so I'm going to draw for you what these curves generally look like. So this is going to be the end product. And the x-axis is going to be percent non-conforming. And we're going to commonly write it down as 100 times the percent non-conforming in that lot. And the y-axis is percent of lots accepted. And this will commonly be written as 100 times P, capital P, superscript A. So how do we interpret this graph? Well, let's just pick a point and talk about it. Let's say this point, this black dot, represents, 2% nonconforming. Let's say that's 2. In that case, first of all, I need to tell you that this scale goes up to 100. So if we had 2% nonconforming, let's say this lines up to be 95% lots accepted. So we have 2% nonconforming. That means about 95% of the lots will be accepted. Okay, next I want to teach you the 5 steps to construct one of these OC operating characteristic curves. Okay, step number 1 is to assume the percent nonconforming. This will make sense as I show you a table in the next slide. But basically for now, just think about it. We're assuming each of these values. So we're just going to arbitrarily pick them and then back calculate what each of these corresponding percent lots accepted values are. Okay, step number 2 is to calculate the NP value. So for each of these P values, we're just going to multiply times how many we have in our sample size. Okay, the third step is to obtain the PA values. And now that we've talked about probability distributions and the probability theorems, you should be familiar with how to determine these. But the good news is we have a shortcut where there's a table in the back of a textbook that we can use to determine each of these values. And I'll show you how to do that in a future video. But for now, just start bracing yourself for going back to Poisson distributions, the hypergeometric distributions, and so on. Okay, step number 4 is my favorite part, because this is when we get to plot this data. And then step 5 is we're going to repeat steps 1 through 3 until we get the rest of these values. So we're going to assume this one, we're going to multiply it times n, then we're going to get each of the values for the y-axis, then we're going to plot those as we do it, so we'll plot them one by one, and then we'll repeat them all together. Okie dokie, so what I want to do to put this all together is show you this table that I found from the 9th edition of Del H. Besterfield's Quality Improvement book, which I find to be a good elementary introduction to these concepts. So here you can see what he's done with regard to step number 1, is he just arbitrarily chose these p-values starting at 0.01, so that would be 1%. And then to do step number 2, he started this column where he multiplied those individual p-values times n, the sample size. So the data for number 2 is actually in this column. So far, we've completed steps 1 and 2. And then the next step was for each of these individual rows, he determined the probability of acceptance. And I'm going to show you how to look those up, but we're looking at, most generally speaking, the Poisson distribution works for most cases. Okay, so now that we have a column of these p-values, which were basically 100 times that one, and we have this column of 100 times the probability of acceptance, which is basically 100 times that one, now we have the data for our x and our y axes. And now we can plot that data into a graph that looks somewhat like this.
Okay, I just walked you through a very elementary introduction to acceptance sampling plans. When we get to class, I'll give you some example problems, we'll practice on them, then we'll tighten up the complexity here a little bit as we get into the other types of acceptance sampling plans, And then we'll talk about how to analyze and interpret these acceptance sampling plans. And then the best part is when we talk about how to cater these sampling plans towards particular customers or consumers and the processors, yourself as the producer or the processor of the food. That'll make sense when we get to those videos. But in the meantime, I look forward to seeing you in class tomorrow morning.